Welcome to my channel. If you don't know me, my name is Teresa. I am a surface pattern designer and watercolor artist. If you've been here before, then welcome back. And thank you all so much for helping my channel grow. Today's tutorial is a really fun one. We are going to use sea salt to create some incredible textures on ocean animals. I'll show you a whale, a hermit crab, and a blue crab. And they all three have subtle differences, so it's real important to watch all three. Now, sea salt can be used for a lot of things. You can use it in galaxies, you can use it as starry skies, you can use it for snowfall, you can use it for snow on the ground. Basically anything that has kind of a furry texture or blurry texture. I have seen people use it as kind of an abstract fur on various animals. You can use it on dandelions, you know, the little things that you blow and the seeds all blow away. Those are a real fun one of those as well. So there are a lot of uses for sea salt, but I wanted to show you ocean animals today because one, I love ocean animals, and two, it's a great way to really highlight just how dramatic of a change you can make in your watercolors by adding the sea salt. So I hope you have a great time with this one. So real quick, I am going to use the black Indian ink by Winsor & Newton, and this basic brush, it's a color shaper by Royal Sovereign. It's just a basic round brush. It doesn't have a number on it, but I think it's an 8. It's either an 8 or a 6, but the reason why I like it so much is because it had that rubber tip on the other end, I hope you noticed that. That's what I use to put on this masking fluid. And all the supplies, of course, are going to be listed below with links. But this is Dr. Martin's Frisket masking fluid that I've just put over the eye area and the mouth and the little pieces above the fins. So now I'm going to drop in this ink and just let it do its magic. I'll just touch it in several spots where I've placed that clear water. And we want to keep this very, very liquidy as much as possible. The salt will soak that up. So I'm going to do this in sections because it will dry so fast. Ink, to me, it dries much faster than, you know, regular watercolor. So I get it very wet. And then drop these. This is rock salt, by the way. I get the largest salt I can find, really. And then I will also come back with some coarse salt and some table salt. So we can have a variety of texture. The thing to note here is try not to let the salt, especially the larger pieces, hang halfway on and halfway off. Because what's going to happen is when the salt absorbs that water, then it will wick into the other part of the salt that's not actually on top of the ink. And then that gets your paper messed up. So if you don't want it to go outside those margins, do not allow the salt to overlap those margins. Sometimes I will do that just to make an uneven, you know, like where the barnacles are, like an uneven edge. But I try not to do that. I try to do that naturally, like with where I place the water, and not rely on the salt to do that, just because it's a little unpredictable that way. But if I place the water where I want it and keep the salt on the water, then it's not a problem. The underside of a whale is usually lighter. So I'm not going to put as much ink on the underside. And you can see that I'm using some kind of dirty water here where I've allowed the ink to get into the water, and that's fine. It's not much. And I also try to go over on top of rather my pencil lines, because the black ink will cover those pencil lines up. I do wish that I had spread this out just a little more evenly. I typically do, and I don't know why I did not do that on this one, but I'll go back later and smooth that out a little more. It's just much harder to do that with ink than it is with watercolor. Watercolor is pretty easy, but ink, it's really not. And we'll talk more about that in just a little while. But so now I'm just going to do this underside. And so the reason why I have the masking fluid where the mouth is so that I can control that mouth line later. I will go back with the fine liner and just make it a little more smooth and defined so that it's more obvious that it's a mouth. And now I'm trying to very carefully put those salt pieces in place. And you can do as much or as little as you want. On the whale, sometimes I do a lot more, and you'll see on some of the other animals, but this one I decided I just want these barnacle kind of spots around the head and on the fins, of course, and I'll put a little bit on the back fins, but not a lot. And it's almost impossible to keep the salt in place. Just be careful when you're pushing it back on there. That's where accidents tend to happen. One way to control how dramatic of an effect you have with salt is by timing. When do you put the salt on? So on the head and the fins, I am going to apply the salt immediately. I really don't want it to dry much because I want it to be very strong. Then, if you've noticed, I've left the tail to dry a little bit, and I will go back and add salt in a minute after it's dried, just to have a little bit more subtle effect. The ink, because I've not smoothed it out, I've just allowed it to bleed where it wants to, it is making a texture on its own. So that's just a style choice I've decided, is that I will allow the tail to dry and then I'm going to apply a little bit so that we have a little bit there. But I really want most of it elsewhere. Another thing you can do is to apply the salt with tweezers, well, especially the rock salt. And that's also known as ice cream salt too. Just, you may know it by that name, but you can do it with tweezers. It just takes longer to do that, and I just don't ever find the need to take that kind of time with it. I have pretty good luck with doing it with my fingers, and you know, the few little times, and you'll see on the crab, it accidentally bleeds over, and I'm able to fix it, you know. We'll talk about that when we get there, but as long as you're careful and you don't have a lot of mishaps, you can usually touch up and it's fine. The real problem occurs when it bounces off and goes across your paper, so be careful of that. So now it's dry, so let's take a look. I usually let these dry overnight. Now for this project, I let them dry for 4 to 5 hours. And sometimes you can test it and you may think that it's dry enough after a couple of hours, but then when you're taking it off, there'll be a wet spot and then it smears. So I allow 5 hours is a good rule of thumb if you're not going to let it go overnight. But letting it go overnight, you're just guaranteed it's going to be real dry. And you want it so dry that it is sticking to your painting. And I've never had one tear. It doesn't stick that hard. But I also leave some of the ones that are a little tougher, I just leave them. You know, they'll eventually fall off or not. And I just think it's really a nice 3D kind of effect to have that. But as you see, I mean, these look like barnacles. Isn't that amazing? I just love it. I mean, it's so amazing to me. And also, you can reuse your salt, but a little warning, like this salt was with black ink, so I will only use that salt with another project that uses black ink, or else once it gets wet again, it could put black ink onto my new painting. So if you're going to reuse it, just try to stick with the same colors. And here I'm just using a very watered down Winsor & Newton black, just, and I think I put a little sepia in here too, just to give a little bit of a shadow on the belly so that it defines that edge between that white belly and the white paper. And now I'm just drawing those, I forget what those are called on the whale, those little lines under the mouth and belly area, and just hinting at it. And I'm also smoothing out that black ink that I did not smooth out in the beginning, which I regret. But if you saw me use a little white sponge a minute ago, that, believe it or not, is a magic eraser. And it doesn't work as well with ink, but it is truly magic with watercolor. So this is the end of the whale. I didn't want to take up all your time by, you know, having you watch me paint every little thing about it. But as you can see, there's not much salt left on here. So those big pieces especially look 3D, like the big three on the tail and then all on this fin on the right hand side. There is no salt left behind there. That is all paint, or ink rather. So let's move on to our crab. I am going to use the Prima Confections Complexion Set. It's by Art Philosophy. And I just use a variety of these colors, and this is all I'm really going to use on the shell part. And the other colors that I use for the actual crab, I'll list that below too, just in case you want to know. So I've already put the water down, and now I'm just really just picking and choosing which colors I want. I'm putting a little bit of the gold down just to give it a little shimmer. And I'm also going to use, that pink is a lemonade shade, they call it. Then I also use the peach cobbler and the namaste. I'm mixing it all up because I want a lot of texture and I want a lot of colors. Just all those earthy colors. So I'll just place that down, and I do want to do it in a spiral motion so that that comes through. And so now I'm taking the redwood and just placing a little bit of that on some of the darker edges, and I'm just encouraging that spiral type texture and movement, I guess is what I'm really trying to say. Now, if you'll notice, I put the masking fluid on the outside of this shell as well as over the actual crab pieces. And I really didn't have to do the crab himself, but I thought, you know, I'll just for fun cover him up too. But I did go on the outside just to contain any spillage a little bit. I've never done that before, but I thought it would be fun to try it since this is such a small piece. You know, some masking fluids might leave a stain, and I typically don't like using masking fluid when I am going to leave it on overnight. That's an awful long time to have masking fluid on, and you do run the danger of it staining your paper. But so far, this Dr. Martin's has done a good job for me. I've not left it on overnight yet though, but this did stay on for a good 5 hours, and it did not stain my paper on any of these three that I've done today. So I did not use quite as much water on this one. And that is going to affect the intensity of the patterns, because there's not as much water and pigment for the salt to soak up. So we can expect that the texture is going to be a finer texture, which I thought was appropriate for this type of seashell. It's seashells like this are more sandy, really, to me. So even though I'm using large rock salt and a lot of finer salt this time, I'm using more of the table salt this time than I did with the whale. And now it's dry and I'm just peeling it back, and it's very stuck down, which is fine. I like that it's kind of a glittery look to it, which is very beach shell like. And there's one piece there that's really stuck, but I'm not going to force it up. We'll just let it come up on its own. And this is looking really nice. I like this. Now I will go back and take a darker brown and define those shadows in the curvature of the shell a little more, just to add that depth. And as you see, I'm peeling up the masking fluid, and it did not stain it. So I'll probably go ahead and take all of this up, because we really don't need it anymore. And then I will paint the crab, and I won't make you watch that either. But I'm gonna leave behind some of this salt, because it's adding a nice crystally kind of sandy look. And then, so after I finished painting the crab, I decided that this guy looked like he was floating in midair with his little feet dangling. So I'm going to go back and add a little bit of sand texture. And I just want it very light. I'm not going to overdo it. I'm really not using much water here, just because I don't want it to compete with the shell. So I'll do it a little bit lighter, and definitely lighter in texture. So I'm only really using the table salt and the coarse salt mixture. There are a couple of larger pieces in here, but that was just by accident. Okay, let's see how it looks. Yep, see, that's much finer. It's very subtle, which is a nice compliment, I think, to the whole crab. And again, I think I'll just leave some of that on there. That's kind of nice. And now he doesn't look like he's floating anymore. Okay, moving on to the blue crab. So I'm just showing you this part because I want you to see the colors that I'm using. Now, this brighter green over on the left, far left side, I did not use. I thought I might. I had it out just in case, but I really decided not to do it. So I used all four of these opened Ecoline colors. The other bottle back in the background is a marine blue that I will mix half and half with a deep violet later on off camera to do the purpley colors that are just little hints around the tips of his claws. So I really wanted you to see this part. Because this is such a big piece, I had to do it in sections, much like the whale, only this one was much more sections. I did each arm as a section, and now the body is the real fun part. And I am dropping in every one of those Ecoline colors, all four of them, just at random, just moving it about. And so I use the masking fluid to cover up little details, like this crab has a lot of little spikes on it that are kind of an off-white color. So I didn't want those to get blue, so I covered those up. And when I laid the water down, I did not go all the way up to the seam line where it touches the legs. I wanted to come back with this fine liner and just tease that color up to those lines. Now that was just in case part of the legs were not completely dry, they wouldn't start bleeding much. So I waited and did it with the fine liner. That way I could control how much was actually touching them. And it all ended up fine. None of them bled into it. But I did kind of rush it a little bit with moving on to this part because this just took so long to do this. But this worked really well. And it's pooling along the edge here. And that's okay, because our salt is going to soak it up. And be careful when you do this. I did not do those four legs off to the right here because I knew I needed to place my hand down and I didn't want to run the risk of touching it. So you kind of have to plan those sorts of things out ahead of time. And I'm not putting as much salt on the crab as I did, well, especially on the seashell, but not even as much as the whale. And that's just because I don't want as much texture. I want larger texture, so I'm not going to use as much of the smaller salt. I will use some, but not as much. And I'm going to be kind of picky about where I place all of this. If you look up by the nose on the right-hand side, there's a piece of salt that rolled off the edge. And when I move it back right there, you see how it stained the paper? Because it soaked it up and then it leaked over into the other side of that piece of salt. So luckily, this crab has some kind of pincher kind of things up by the nose. So I will just paint over that with the purple mixture that I'm going to mix up. And that will just be the placement for one of the pinchers. So that was lucky that that happened in that spot. Okay, let's take it off. I like how on this one, where the little salt pieces were, it looks very different than it did on the whale. And that's because some colors react a little differently than other colors. And the amount of water and pigment can make a difference in the way it appears as well. Well, that's about it for this one. I hope you enjoyed this. Please, if you do it, take pictures of it. Tag me on Instagram with your pictures so that I can see them. Or if you're not going to post on social media, then send me one by email. I really would love to see what you create with this technique. Here's one more close-up view of each one. And now that you know what to look for, I bet you can see the differences in each one. Have a great creative day, and I hope to see you back again soon for more tutorials.